The joint briefing for the Subcommittee on International Organizations, Human Rights, and the Subcommittee on Europe will come to order. On behalf of the Subcommittee's ranking member, Mr. Rohrabacher, and myself, let me thank Chairman Wexler and his ranking member, Mr. Gallagher, and their staff for arranging this joint briefing. This will be our second joint event with the Subcommittee on Europe, and we look forward to others where our interests and jurisdictions overlap. Our Subcommittee has been conducting a series of hearings on foreign attitudes regarding United States policies. Attitudes which we need to understand if we are to encourage cooperation among our allies in the struggle against international terrorism and other issues important to American national interests. In the wake of the horrific attacks on the United States on September 11th, we were moved by the extraordinary support, the outpouring of sympathy from across the globe. I shall never forget the headline in the French newspaper Le Monde that proclaimed, "Today we are all Americans." Sadly, that support has eroded dramatically. In previous hearings, well-regarded pollsters testified how world opinion has turned against the United States in recent years. In our Government Accountability Office, which is a nonpartisan adjunct to the United States Congress, has concluded that this reality, this trend of opinion against the United States has profound negative consequences for our national interests. Like American public opinion, foreign public opinion has been affected by the war in Iraq, by disturbing images of prisoner abuse at Abu Ghraib, by the administration's flouting of the Geneva Conventions at Guantanamo, and by other unnecessary excesses in the execution of our counterterrorism strategy. One initiative that has prompted severe rebuke, particularly from Europe, is the Bush administration's practice of so-called extraordinary renditions. Today we will review that practice and hear a report from members of the European Parliament. For those of you that are unfamiliar with this term, I'm referring to the practice by U.S. government officials of seizing individuals suspected of links to Al-Qaeda and other terrorist organizations and transferring them to third countries, such as Syria or Egypt, where they have reportedly faced cruel treatment or torture. Some news reports have called this our torture by proxy program, or as one of the witnesses, the minority witness in the second panel, Mr. Shura, said recently in a 60-minute program, it's very convenient. It's finding someone else to do your dirty work. The European Parliament's report, which we are addressing today, also includes in its analysis of extraordinary renditions the forcible abduction of suspects who are then transferred to secret CIA detention facilities for interrogation. We also know that the practice did not come into existence during the Bush administration. Apparently, some form of rendition has been in practice for decades. But according to press reports, the program has been expanded by the Bush administration in both its reach and scope. The methods used in the Bush program are apparently inconsistent with our broader foreign policy goals of promoting democracy and respect for the rule of law. They have brought us condemnation and could easily frustrate our efforts to work in a concerted way with our allies in fighting terrorism. All the while, the goals of the program could have been achieved if the administration had worked with Congress to craft a policy that would have respected our international obligations and norms. Again, quoting Mr. Shoya, he had this to say in a frontline program. The administration apparently decided that they didn't want to go through the trouble of working with Congress to find a way to bring them to the U.S. as POWs, as enemy combatants, or whatever. More importantly, these renditions appear to violate our obligations under the Convention Against Torture and other international treaties. Pursuant to that treaty, the Convention's Committee Against Torture reviewed the actions of the United States. Here are a few of their conclusions and recommendations as they are relevant to the practice of extraordinary rendition. That committee expressed concern about allegations that the United States has established secret detention facilities, which are not accessible to the International Committee of the Red Cross. Detainees are purportedly deprived of fundamental legal safeguards, including an oversight mechanism in regard to their treatment and review procedures with respect to their detention. The committee recommends that the U.S. should ensure that no one is detained in any secret detention facility under its de facto effective control. Detaining persons in such conditions constitutes a violation of the convention. The United States should investigate and disclose the existence of any such facilities and the authority under which they have been established and the manner in which detainees are treated. The U.S. should publicly condemn any policy of secret detention. That committee also expressed concerns about reports of the involvement of the United States in so-called enforced disappearances. They recommend that the U.S. adopt all necessary measures to prohibit and prevent enforced disappearance in any territory under its jurisdiction and prosecute and punish perpetrators, as this practice too constitutes a violation of the Convention Against Torture. The committee also expressed concern about the United States' use of so-called diplomatic assurances or other kinds of guarantees assuring that a person will not be tortured if expelled, returned, transferred, or extradited to another state. Imagine accepting the assurances of Uzbekistan or Syria. Let me suggest that this is the ultimate in naivete or just a sham. They recommend that the United States establish and implement clear procedures for obtaining such assurances, with adequate judicial mechanisms for review and effective post-return monitoring arrangements. Now, people across the globe have admired our historical commitment to freedom and the rule of law, but they are appalled at our hypocrisy when we betray our values. The United States recently issued its annual Human Rights Country Reports criticizing abusive practices carried out overseas. How much credibility can such a report carry when we ourselves are purportedly involved in abusive practices? What does the world think when we won't even talk to the Syrians, but will send terrorist suspects to them for questioning? And we should remember that if the world opinion of America continues to erode, democracy will suffer everywhere in our national interest. Our national interest will be the victim. Congress has a role here in ensuring that our laws, our values are respected by any administration, Republican or Democratic. Congress unfortunately abdicated its oversight responsibility, a failure which these hearings will begin to correct. I'm confident that the House Committee on the Judiciary will initiate a series of hearings on these particular issues. But while Congress took no action, others stepped up to the plate. Much of what we know about the Renditions program is known because of the important work of news agencies and non-governmental organizations. In January, the European Parliament made an important contribution to the debate by issuing a report on what the CIA was doing in Europe and on their own government's apparent complicity in its operations. Today we will hear from two European parliamentarians, Claudio Fava and Baroness Sarah Ludford, involved in preparing that report. Another member of the Parliament, Jonathan Evans, will speak on the impact this practice has had on our transatlantic relationship. On our expert panel, Julianne Smith from the Center for Strategic International Studies will also discuss how the practice has affected European cooperation with the United States. Mr. Michael Scheuer, former chief of the Bin Laden unit at the CIA, will likewise make a statement. I look forward to their testimony.